I'm just going to share a couple more things concerning the trip, and then we will proceed. And after, we're going to be sharing some highlights of some powerful testimonies. As I said, we went to a place, Constitution Hill, and that, if you know Jamaica, it's above Papine. Way up in the hills, the roads are scary. You know what I mean? Every time certain people were driving in the vehicle and they were hanging on, I have to say I'm going to tell certain people, because certain people are just holding on to me when they see the precipice and the corners, you know? So in the minivan then, if you don't even know people, they will be holding on to you. Praise God. But God took us there safely. And this church, it was a Tuesday, and the church was pretty much full with people. And this is an Adventist church. And I praise God, I got the opportunity where I could share a few testimonies and just talk about the goodness of God and how much I appreciate a church like that, where you are able to commune and see Adventists who are really able to pray and pray and pray and praying for people who are demon possessed. You know, so and the worship is just unbelievable. It's all about praise, reading the word. There's no break. And I know my dear sister spoke about the reverence, where they will just call you out and say, "Don't you respect God?" It was very powerful. It was an experience where it's a place where people will pilgrimage to go get there, just to experience the power. And I know as we work with them, there's going to be much. And a lot of people needed help. The need is so great there that is, you know, it's unbearable. I saw a young lady with three children, young children, and you could see that she's in need. And I spoke to her. We have her contact, and I know we are going to be seeing how we can help and support. I received many calls from there already. While I was in Jamaica, I prayed for a few people who have the connection to Constitution Hill. So it was just an amazing opportunity to see people of God down in the Word and nonstop praying, and people coming and sharing testimonies of how God has delivered them from since they have been coming to that church. That is just an amazing opportunity. So after Constitution Hill, that was the Tuesday. As a matter of fact, when I went down on the Friday, I went to a home on the Sabbath. And I'm able to share a few things about the home. We went to pray for a little girl who is possessed. And this is an Adventist family. And the thing about it is that praying for her, you know right away that it's a spiritual warfare, because she started to cry that something is hurting her in her stomach, and then it moved to her head and she's screaming, and it was just unbelievable. Mom and Dad was right there watching. And the thing though is I can't share detail of this testimony unless I get permission, but it was very powerful. But what I may say is that a lot of Adventists was around in the home. There's quite a number of people because of an event they had to go to. And they were in the home, and you could see that they're not familiar with things like this. So it was difficult. It was easier to witness to a person who is not an Adventist more than an Adventist when it comes to spiritual warfare. And we have to ask the question, is the Sabbath keeping people sleeping or not? I mean, Jesus' ministry spoke about demon possession and casting out demons. And here it is, we are there, and the people of God don't believe. They have doubt. They ask many questions. And I'm saying, mercy. One day people are going to recognize this battle, that this is really powerful. And, you know, God bless, and I just want to say thanks to the mom and dad. I don't know if they're listening, but I want to say thanks because the Lord was able to show them, because the dad have a powerful discerning spirit. And I'm telling you, no joke. And mom also, God is going to use this family. They have a little daughter that have the power of discerning spirit. I'm telling you, I was blown away with what happened there. And that was the Sabbath. And then the Sunday, it was like a day of just praying and resting up for the coming week. And the coming week, as we said, was very challenging. Very, very challenging. And, you know, a lot of things happen by just fasting. Because what the Lord was showing us is that when God's people pray, everything is by faith. The next level is faith. And I am so filled because God was able to deliver a case that is so powerful. Because you see, the problem is that when we got the young lady into the room to pray for her, as soon as we reach a level, she will want to come out the room. We can't contain her in the room. And she's backing me off constantly, like shielding me. When I'm praying and I go to her, she will be shielding me everywhere I go. Like, you can't pray for me. But the long and short is, God was saying to us that the mind, we learn a lot of powerful things about fallen angels. You know, it's so powerful. I just need a lot of time to share and to share sometimes, share some things on the prayer line. Because I don't know if you know that there's a difference between fallen angel, there's a difference between agent of Satan, and there's a difference between demonic angels. There's a difference. You can ask some question after. But what I'm trying to say is that the power that was there that came down to battle with us was unprecedented. It's out of this world. And I praise God. My niece was there, and she have a special anointing, and we were able to experience that. We experience it. And I think after the service, I'm going to share with some people here. And those who are on the prayer line, you better try and make your way here. Sorry. But it was unbelievable. And I really respect God, because we gained the deliverance without going to the room that where she was. And you know that how that happened? Most of the study, we fasted for 4 days. And the fast start at 12 o'clock in the day and end 6 o'clock in the morning without sleeping. And when it ends, imagine you're so tired. Till by the time you think of getting one meal, you're already trying to see if you can get 1 hour sleep and be prepared for the next round. And it's an experience with God. Because God took us through all the study. And I know my prayer partner have all the studies that we've been through. We studied the entire, like, Elijah. Because God says he wants to pour out the Elijah spirit upon us before we can even pray for her. So we had to study the difference between Elijah, and the power that Elijah has. And what is the Elijah message? I know I did a sermon on the Elijah message. You can go online and try find it. I don't remember the title. But is the Elijah message, he said the Elijah message is going to come in Malachi. It's going to come before the day of the Lord. And, you know, a lot of time when I did that sermon, we were wrestling. If Elijah was going to come physically, the way it's stated in the Bible, or if It's the message, but it's the message of revival. And that message, we prayed and the Lord was able to pour His Spirit out upon us. And then when we start to pray, because when you have the spirit of revival, when it says the children will be turned to their parents, you remember that scripture? God asks us now to pray. That young lady's heart or her mind will be turned to Him. I'm telling you, it's so deep, man. It's so deep. When the Lord brought us into the study, and He gave us the Malachi with the and everything lines up. And then He said, go and pray now that her heart or her mind will now turn to Him so He can come in. And the Lord already gave us the assurance that there's two fallen angels that Satan dispatched. And they are powerful so much that we can't even rebuke them. And the powerful thing is that my niece is able to see them. And the Lord dispatched Gabriel. I know it's kind of foreign to some of the people, you know, but the Lord was able to dispatch Gabriel to chain them until the young lady was able to surrender. Because God cannot set you free unless you surrender. It's very powerful. If you want to be free, you have to surrender to Christ. I know I will share more after. I know I got to go to the question box because we are pushing a little bit ahead, but got to go to the question box. Let's see what is here. This question, and it says, should a Christian have an altar in their house, and what should it be? Wow. Should a Christian have an altar? Well, I spoke about this on a few occasions, about setting up an altar. If you notice in Genesis, quite a bit of times, the Lord's servants, I will see if I can find it, the Lord's servants set up an altar to God, the Almighty. Look with me to Genesis 8, verse 20. 8 verse 20. And it says, and Noah built an altar unto the Lord, and took of every clean beast, and of every clean fowl, and offered burnt offerings on the altar. That is prayers. That is sending up requests to God. He had a place where he met God. And look what verse 21 says. And it says, and the Lord smelled a sweet savor. And the Lord said in his heart, I will not again curse the ground. Because he was praying. There's a certain place that you got to meet God. It's all about worship. You see, the place of altar is a place of sacrifice. A place where you meet God. It can be a little box you set up. It's not the type of furniture. It's the significance of the altar. Just a place where you can meet God. I'll do one more scripture. Look at Exodus 17, verse 15. Exodus 17, verse 15. And Moses built an altar and called the name of it Jehovah Nisi. Powerful, a place where God will meet him. If we have an altar and we claim these scriptures, God will meet us there. I gave the testimony many times about setting up an altar to God. It's very, very powerful. And it's just a place, a sacred place where you dedicate to God and say, this is a place I'm going to have as my prayer room. And do you know that all the Hindus and Sikhs, they put special emphasis on their prayer room. You will never go into an Indian home where they don't have a place, even the closet. And if they see the need to pray to an idol God, what about us? who serve the real God, are we willing? The real God we serve. Brethren, God is calling us tonight to make an altar. Let us pray. Father in heaven, great God, we just want to thank you for your righteousness, your glory, and your power. And Lord, we just invite your holy presence to be with us now. May your God reconsecrate this altar of sacrifice. May you reconsecrate the whole sanctuary so that as we pray, O God, you will allow your Holy Spirit to reconsecrate, to break every power of darkness, that nothing will dwell in here unless it's your Holy Spirit presence. So, Lord, we thank you as we give full control over to you. May you touch every hearts on the prayer line. May you touch every hearts that is here. And may your name be glorified. In Jesus Christ's name, I pray. Praise God. I want you to turn with me to, we are in the book of Romans. And we have been going through Romans, and these are deep scriptures that we ought to study personally. Because you see, God wants to take us to a different level. And I praise God for what he has been doing thus far. Chapter 10 is very interesting. It's talking about salvation. And what is more crucial to the Christian walk but to know if we are going to be saved or not? Salvation is very crucial. So you could say then, Christ's mission was to do what? What is the most important thing for the human life? And don't say salvation because I said it, but if you ask some people, they will say the family. Some would say finances, because people are going through a lot. But if the Lord was to really, or if you were to really think about it, what's the most important for the Christian walk? It's salvation. We want to be saved. It's to be saved. But most people are looking at what the family is going through. People are looking at my finances is all destroyed. What am I going to do? I'm telling you, we went to Jamaica and we went to some rough places and poverty is there. It's big time. And as a matter of fact, the church that we went to, I recognize that church holds over 700 people, could be more. And I noticed that on Sabbath, they don't even have lunch there. And people are hungry. And I hope all those who are on the prayer line and here will be able to work with us to implement a system or a program where we can supply lunch to that church every Sabbath, starting March. We're going to organize it and plan it, where people who are hungry can come and have a meal on the Sabbath day. The need is great. You see, mothers with their children. I was able to pray for a few families there. And their cry is, I have no job. There's no food. My son is in depression. There was one mother says, I have nowhere to live. My son is 25. No food. And he's given up on life. And she gave me the number and said, could you call him for me? Because I called him this morning and he said, it doesn't make sense. He's given up. We're having it easy here. I'm telling you, people, it's rough. And we got to have to sacrifice more. But here in this chapter, Paul was talking. And he was looking on the human condition. And Paul had a concern. And look at verse 1 of Romans 10. And it says, brethren, my heart desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. What is your prayer this morning, this evening, this night? Is your prayer that your finances just work out, you get a better job? I mean, Paul says his desire, his passion, his care, it was about the human condition. What is our relationship like with God? He knows that Christ is about to come, and he was reaching out. It was burdensome upon him. His compassion, he was passionate about it and says, my desire, if I had one request, it would be like this. Paul was crying out and says, my desire, if people could just turn their life over. Is that your desire tonight for your family? Is that your desire? You're on the prayer line for Israel, spiritual Israel. If you look, let's look back and go back to Romans chapter 9 and look at verse 6. I'm going to look at verse 6 of Romans chapter 9. And it says, not as though the word of God has taken none effect, for they are not all Israel which are of Israel, neither because they are the seed of Abraham, and they are all children, but in Isaac shall the seed be called. He was reflecting back and says, not all Jews are Jews. Not all Israel are Israelite. In other words, not everybody who had the promise or anybody who said Christ, Christ is going to be saved. Self have to be slaughtered. There's going to have to be sacrifice. And when he looked back on the tradition of the Jews, that they were rigid about the law. We went through the whole book concerning the law. Remember, the wages of sin is death. That's the payment for sin. That's how it was established, because God is a truth God. And what happened now? The Jews had the law, and the law was rigid. They wanted it to be kept perfectly. So therefore, you cannot sin. It's rigid. So Paul is saying, look at it this way. No, if it wasn't for Christ, who can keep the law? I mean, that's what God... You see, if you go back to the plan with Isaac, with Abraham, with all the sacrifices, everything was paved already for the coming of Christ, who is the ultimate sacrifice. But the Jews will not accept that. They were stuck in their old ways, the tradition that you have to keep the law this way. But if you go by the Jewish way, man will not be saved, because we can't keep the law so perfect. And that's why they were so rigid, that they wouldn't do anything on the Sabbath. They wouldn't even take the bus. They will walk. But Christ came. Grace came. And he was saying, listen, my heart goes out for my brethren, Paul, the people, the Jewish people. And hear what he says, because he said, I want them to be saved. I pray. He was in prayer for people, the Jewish nation, and even the Gentiles too, who did not know Christ. He was praying. And it's a lesson here that we should be caring about people's salvation. We should be caring about reaching souls for Christ. And it goes on to say then that while he was compassionate and in prayer, it says in verse 2, it says, for I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to the knowledge. Come on, that's deep. They all want to witness out there in the street, but they don't know the knowledge that Christ came And it's all through Christ can we be saved. Do you know people like that have the zeal, but they don't have the truth? They are pumped up and ready to witness, but they're not doing things right. That's what God is saying. We need to stay away from this. We need to know who Jesus really is for ourselves. Amen. We can't just jump on any bandwagon. He's given us knowledge to pray, to search the scriptures. Paul was saying they are good people. They have the zeal, but they lack the knowledge. They lack the three angels' message. They lack the spirit of prophecy. They lack many things, but they have the zeal. So he was praying for them. Are you worried today? And hear what it says. We got to just go into a little bit. Because you see, if you look at verse 3, let's go to 3 first. And it says, for they being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, having not submitting themselves unto the righteousness of God. Come on, it answered itself. It says that they lack wisdom and they were just seeking after their own righteousness. Selfish ways. Not leaning on God's own understanding. Not seeking that the scripture says we cannot have salvation but through Jesus Christ. They're not recognizing it. They were making their rules and their laws and they're falling into it. Tradition. Are you stuck in your own ways? In tradition? God is saying it's the last days and we need to move away from that. God is calling his people, say it's high time for us to search the scriptures and see what we need to do. There's wisdom, there's direction in the scriptures. I'm going to go to the next verse because there's something significant I want to point out to you. And it says in verse 4, for Christ is the end of the law, for righteousness is everyone that believeth. I'm going to break it down because you see, Paul was speaking, and Paul says righteousness is the end of the law. We're going to talk a little bit about the man Paul and his relationship with God. Because Paul was a witness talking to God's people and saying, listen up. If we want to make a difference, we got to go through Jesus Christ the right way. But he sympathized and said they are ignorant. They don't understand the righteousness of God only comes through Jesus. There's no other way. They want to enter through the back door. And Paul goes on to say, there's no other way but through Jesus. And he says, when Christ is the end of the law of righteousness to everyone that believeth. Pretty much he's saying, listen, all those who are stuck in the law, when Christ came, it was the end of that law. Law now. You recognize that we are saved by grace and faith through Jesus Christ. It's not any longer, you are not any longer subjected to the law. That's what he was saying. Paul was given his experiences of how things work out, how things were when he was out there. I'm going to ask you to turn with me in your Bibles to, we're going to look at Acts chapter 26, verse 9. We're going to go through some scriptures here just to get what the Lord is saying to us. Acts 26, and I will read verse 9 to 14. And hear what it says. It says, I verily thought with myself that I ought to do many things contrary to the name of Jesus of Nazareth. Which thing I also did in Jerusalem, and many of the saints did I shut up in prison, having received authority from the chief priests. And when they were put to death, I gave my voice against them. And I punished them oft in every synagogue, and compelled them to blaspheme, and being exceedingly mad against them, I persecuted them even unto strange cities. This is a testimonial. Whereupon, as I went to Damascus with authority and commission from the chief priests, at midday, O king, I saw in the way a light from heaven, above the brightness of the sun shining round about me, and then which journeyed with me. And when we were all fallen to the earth, I heard a voice speaking unto me and saying in the Hebrew tongue, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? It is hard for thee to kick against the prick. Mercy. And I said, who art thou, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. Paul was given a little bit, he's putting his passion, how he cares about people who don't know the truth. He said, I was there. My passion is no more into vanity and into buildings and families and everything. My passion is into soul winning. I have met Christ, high and lifted up. I want you to look with me to Galatians chapter 1. I'm telling you, these are deep. Just make note of it. Galatians chapter 1. I'll be reading from verse 13 and 14. 13, I'll go up to say 18 then. Galatians. And it says, for ye have heard of my conversation in time past in the Jews' religion, how that beyond measure I persecuted the church of God and wasted it, and profited in the Jews' religion above many my equals in my own nation, being more exceedingly zealous of the tradition of my fathers. But when it pleased God, who separated me from my mother's womb and called me by his grace to reveal his son in me, that I might preach him among the heathen. And immediately I conferred not with flesh and blood, neither went I up to Jerusalem to them which were apostles before me, but I went unto Arabia and returned again unto Damascus. It's just giving you a little idea of Paul's journey to saying, I am speaking from experience. I was there. I used to crucify Christian until my eyes were open. That's why Paul was praying with passion for God's people. He was praying. I want you to turn to our next scripture, Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3. And I want you to look from verse 4. This is deep. And it says, remember, it's Paul speaking, his experience. And it says, though I might also have confidence in the flesh, if any other man thinketh that he has whereof he might trust in the flesh, I more. He's saying, listen, I was trusting in all these things. He said, listen, I was circumcised the eighth day of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, and Hebrew after Hebrews as touching the law of the Pharisee, concerning zeal, persecuting the church, touching the righteous, which is in the law blameless. But what things were again to me, those I counted loss for Christ. No, you got to get it right there. He was saying, I used to do all these things, and I do them no more. I consider it lost. Because you see, I recognize who Jesus really is now. Mercy. And verse 80 says, yea, doubtless, and count all things but loss for the excellency of knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ. And I be found in him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteous, which is of God by faith. Paul was testifying that when he was out there and doing the things of the world, he was doing it with all his heart, thinking that everything was okay. But when he met Christ, he's not looking back behind on the things. I'm telling you, it's really a powerful moment, what Paul was describing here. Paul was saying his care now is about salvation. His care is for the human condition, my families. What is their relationship like now? Are we praying with more zeal and zest for our families and friends? Paul is reaching out, the power of God using Paul to reach out. I want to look down at verse 5. Verse 5. Verse 5 of chapter, we're in back to Romans 10. And verse 5 says, for Moses describeth the righteous which is of the law, that the man which doeth those things shall live by them. He's looking back again, back then. You see, the wrestling is with the old man and the new man. And that's why the wrestling, Paul is saying some people is all about tradition. And the Bible was able to use Moses there to bring Moses back. But I want to move on to a couple main verses that the Lord asked me to really show his people. Look at verse 9. Where it says, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shall believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Yes. You see, he's saying, listen. He's saying to his people tonight. He's saying to his people, if you accept the atoning blood and his grace, his power, his forgiveness, we shall be saved. It's not only holding up and says, I believe in Jesus. And that's what the Lord has been showing us all week. It takes a little bit more. We have to dig in the Word. We have to love God. We have to love our brothers and sisters around us. It's a way where God is teaching us. So here he's saying, if we confess that Christ is really Lord of our lives, it meant that we have to live the life. We have to accept his atoning blood, that he really died for you and I. Amen. That's the power of the cross. It's all the Lord has been showing us. And it says in verse 10, for with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, And with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. You see, the heart. You see, everything happens in the heart. We can say anything verbally, but it's what goes on within the heart. I know I told you about the mission that we're on. And we were looking for the physical. We were looking for the physical, that something is going to happen physically. Until the Lord says, it's by faith. If you really believe and go into prayer, if you believe from the heart and surrender everything, it shall manifest publicly. But first it starts in the heart. I'm telling you, did the Lord promise that all is going to be saved? You know, salvation is paid for the guilty. I'm telling you, we are all guilty. And the Lord paved the way, and salvation is free. But some people are puffed up, and we think that we can make it anyway. We can do anything. We can only make it through Christ Jesus. The Lord is pointing us to the cross. If you look at verse 11, it says, for the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. Paul was saying, listen, the Jews may have a different tradition, but salvation is open. It doesn't matter. If we come and we believe and we call on his name, we're going to be saved. There's no section that says, if you call, I will let you in, but if you call, I won't let you in. He's saying it's free for all those who believe and is willing to comfort and call. God is saying we have work to do. We have to wrestle with God and pray for our relatives. Probably Paul was such a powerful prayer warrior because of his experience, because of the sad moment that he has been through. You see, Paul was having this zeal, but when he met Christ, he was persecuted. He went through a lot of down moments, sadness. They accused him, many things he'd been through. So now he was able to encourage. He was able to pray for his neighbors sincerely. Probably we are not going through enough tests. Probably we are not going through enough. We worry about our finances. We worry about what issues we are going through too much. We haven't been through the real tests. I meant when we went to Jamaica, and the Lord says, fast for 4 days. And when you think you are in the island where you want some good food, and you are here and fast for 4 days, I am saying to God, is this for real? You know, is this for real? You know, 4 days? And I'm wrestling in my head, you know, to say, wow, 4 days. But it's going to come to a time when our food is going to be fasting. God is preparing us. Come on, how many people would do that? Fasting for 4 days to help somebody. You're not being paid for it. That's the love Paul is talking about when he has the passion. He has been through it. He experienced the power of God. He experienced persecution. So therefore he's saying, man, you guys have no idea that there's one way and it's only through Christ. We can't look on the old way. We got to turn from our old way, the tradition. There's only one way and it's through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. There's no other way. We got to ask God to give us that passion. where we can come to him in prayer and pray. In verse 14, he said, "How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher?" Mercy. What Paul is saying, there's a lot of people who don't know him. We need to go forth and preach the gospel message. But how can we go forth if we ourselves don't know him? I want to tell you that God has been teaching us. I'm telling you, it's not, if you come to the inner circle when we pray for people, your experience will be different. Because when God is going to tell us to do something, he asks us to study like 4 or 5 chapters in the Bible first. I'm telling you, if we're going to pray for a situation, I want to tell you that 80% is reading the word that relates to that deliverance and understanding the power of God before we start to pray. I'm telling you, especially when me and my niece have some big case and we are praying about it, the Lord will give us the scripture and says, "I want you to study this scripture." And when you study this scripture, then you're going to understand what I'm saying. There was one scripture he told us on the mission to study. And it's, was it Daniel chapter 3? Daniel chapter 3. About the image. He was trying to tell us about the 3 Hebrew boys. That they had the power on them. And we need the power to bring down that image. The image is massive. And you know, when I read it, we were getting some, thinking about some different. Why would God give us Daniel 3 about the Hebrew boys and about the image, the Babylonian image that is so massive? But after praying, the Holy Spirit came through powerful and says, "Listen, the power came down on those 3 Hebrew boys. That's the power available to destroy pretty much that image. The power of darkness. That's the power you're dealing with in this case. We need to call on heaven for power." It's wisdom in Christ. We cannot accept Christ and go further without the wisdom of the word. We start to learn how important the word is. But some people read the word, but they are not doers of the word. So don't go reading the word if you're not doing it. If you are reading it and doing it, then praise God. It works together. Works, faith without works is dead. And God was leading us through the scriptures. And he's saying right here, the harvest is ready. God needs serious people. And Paul prayed that this thing is serious. He prayed and said, "Listen, Christ came and he presented us just before God." It's all about justification by faith. He's calling us, brethren. In verse 15 it says, "And now shall they preach, except they be sent, as it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah said, Lord, who has believed our report? So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God." All of Romans is saying like the same thing. It's all about the law, getting rid of the old man, putting on Christ, so Christ can present us just before God, so we can win the victory. And we have seen it, where God is so powerful. The whole aim about this chapter, the whole thing is between verse 1 to 4. If you are going to leave with anything tonight, you got to remember the passion that Paul has for people, for human beings, their salvation. He's praying that we will have this passion for your neighbor, for your friends, for your dad, your sisters, your brothers. And it only comes through Jesus. And he says in verse 2, "For I bear them record." He's saying from my experience that I shared in the different scriptures, I've been through it. What I'm sharing with you, I live it. How can we be a witness without having experience? I've been tested. How can we be a witness if we don't have any testimonial to share how the Lord has led me? Paul was able to go back and says, "I was a vagabond. I did all these evil things to Christian, trying to uphold the law. But I failed. I failed." Christ is really powerful. He's saying tonight, listen, if you only surrender everything, it can only accomplish through Christ. Some of us are going through a hard time, but the Lord is saying, listen, it's a test. I'm giving you a test so you can share. So when you come out of the wilderness, sister, you are able to share your testimony that you were in the wilderness for 5 years, 10 years, no job. But you didn't give up. You kept going and calling on Christ. And one day, he heard your cry. Because in this wilderness, you are learning. During this fast for the 4 days, we were learning. It wasn't easy. We're tired and weak, but we're learning to lean on Christ. That is through his divine power we depend, not on our strength. That's why it says when we're weak, then he's strong. That's what we have to do, surrender. So Paul's letter to all of us is to say, keep holding on. Pray for that passion like Paul, so we can reach our families and friends. That's what we're going to need in the last days. I praise God. In closing, I share this morning that I have a lineup of people in Jamaica to pray for. But there was one lady, she sent a message. She was in the hospital, and she just got back home. And while she was there, she sent a message and said, if she could only hold my hand. I don't have the time, I'm passing to the airport, if she could only hold my hand. So that moved me with compassion. And while we were going, I recognized that the flight is 1:30. And I was close to her house. It was close to 12. And it's still a distance to the airport. And we know that if you don't get there within a certain time, they close off the station. And when it got close to her home, I said, I didn't even say anything to this amazing prayer partner, Sister Jeanette, that the Lord used with such power out there. She said, she didn't even say anything. She just passed. You know, it's a hard time to even make it there. When I got to the airport, it was after 12. And I ran in, and when I got in there, God provided this gentleman who works there. He just came and went from everybody and helping me with everything, weighing the baggage and say, this need to transfer to that. And he's helping me. And I'm saying, because I was observing him and there were so many people. So he helped me, and when everything was done and I check in the baggage, I heard that the flight got delayed. And it's not going to go now until quarter to four. From 1:30 to quarter to four. So I started to wrestle and I said, you know what? I'm going back to see this lady. Sorry. So I went to the gentleman and I said, what do you think if I was to leave the airport now and go somewhere? So he asked me how far. And I told him and he said, well, you're taking a great risk. Because if the flight come in earlier, they're going to call for the people. I would get back here by after 2 or 2:30. I don't know. It's up to you. I said, okay, I'm going to trust God. So I called Sister Jeanette and says, she says she's half an hour away, but she's coming back. Because we have the zeal and the zest for Christ to reach soul. I've never met this lady. I don't know her. But yet I want to leave the airport and go back just to pray for her. And it's not for money. It's the love of God in my heart and the Holy Spirit working. So here it is now. I went. She came. She picked me up. We drove there. We got to the house. They opened the gate and we went in. And I said on the prayer line this morning that I don't want to share detail, but a lot of accursed things were there. I went in and my head started to hurt me instantly. And I was standing up and the Lord is saying, you got to tell her the truth. And I'm telling you, she was so delighted, such amazing woman. And she sat there, her face glowing up, and I saw her relatives were coming from different parts of the U.S. and everywhere because she was well-loved. She's well-loved. And they came, and they came, and they surround, and they came inside. And she introduced them to me, and she told them the story that God delayed the flight just for her. That's how God loved her, that he stopped a whole aircraft for her. And she was explaining to them, and then I introduced myself, and when you look around, she called everybody. We were together about 12 or 13 people. And I start to share the love of Christ and start to point out right before her, she have two Freemason things put down there. Did not know that they were Freemasons. She was a collector of art, and one young man came and took them up right away when I said and brought them out. The long and short is God is so powerful. When I finished there and we get outside, rush in the car, it was 3:05. Around somewhere, 9 or 3:05. We jump in and the traffic was crazy. If you know, close to Beverly Hills there, we're going down to go all the way to airport. And on the way there, I'm watching the time and I'm praying and say, God, you have to do something. Then, long and short, by the time we get there, it was about 3:20. And the flight's supposed to leave 3:45. And I have a long way to walk. So, you see, God has given us the spirit of boldness and not of fear. Praise God. I know I'm wrapping up. And here it is now. I got inside, and when I go, there's nobody at the line. Like, when I'm walking in, and they're like, oh, this is a flight. It's already board long time, you know. So I rushed, and when I got up to the lunch area, I saw some people were there. So I said, you know what? I have time then. So I ordered some food, sorry, because I was hungry. I haven't eaten in days, too. You know, it was, I see food, you know, and it's vegetarian food. So I ordered some food. And I sat there and ate, and it was about 20 to now. Around 20 to or close to 1:45. And I go through and walk all the way. And when I got there to the, you know, the last counter where you go through the booth, the walkway to go into the plane, It was only the one lady standing there waiting. And when I show her, she says, the flight is almost ready. It's board, it's ready. When I got in the plane, it was within 5 minutes they closed the door. And the plane was taxiing out. So I'm just saying this not to say it's a boastful or it's me. It's just the power of God. Because God wanted me to go to pray for that family. I'm telling you, the power of God. That's how God wants us to have this zeal and be determined that even if that flight didn't make it, God will provide a next one. That's what God wants us to do, to step out in faith, believing in the power of God. Tonight, I'm encouraging you to go through that book of Romans 10 again and see the passion that Paul have for soul. God wants us to have that passion because Christ already presented us justification by faith. May God bless us tonight. May God be with us. May his love covers us. And may we all be blessed tonight. In Jesus' name, praise God.